Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Center for Strategic and International Studies. My name is Heather Conley. I'm Senior Vice President here at CSIS for Europe, Eurasia, and the Arctic, and I direct our Europe program. What an absolute privilege and pleasure it is to bring such a spectacular panel together to talk about a subject that we don't speak about as frequently as we should. Sometimes we tend to do that with successes. We herald the negotiation, we see that things are moving well, and then we turn to our next crisis. So it seems hard to believe that it was 18 years ago that the Good Friday peace accords were signed, but we are reminded as acts of violence have flared up most recently that the work continues. And so it is with great pleasure that we are able to have this conversation about not only where we are with the implementation of the Good Friday Accords and the most recent agreements, whether that's the Stormont Agreement, the Fresh Start Agreement, but it's also to put this issue in a broader context, which is the upcoming June 23rd UK referendum on the EU, which will have significant implications for Northern Ireland, for the peace process itself. So I thought we would begin. Senator Mitchell is stuck in traffic at the moment, so we're going to just proceed on, and as soon as he arrives, he's going to jump into this conversation. But let me begin by introducing our panelists, and as I said, the stars literally and figuratively have aligned because we have stars with us today. To my far right, we have Dan Lawton, who is the Consul General, U.S. Consul General in Belfast, a position he assumed in July of 2015. Previously, Dan served as Deputy Director of the Office of Southern European Affairs and the Bureau of European and Eurasian Affairs at the State Department. He has served as the political counselor at the American Embassy in Athens and has served in a variety of other posts. I'm so glad that I met Dan when I worked at the State Department when he was the political military officer in Copenhagen. So it's wonderful to see you, Dan, here. And thank you for joining us to give us that bird's eye view from Belfast. Then again, I'll just keep going down the table here. We are delighted to have Ambassador Mitchell Reiss, who is the president and CEO of the Colonial Williamsburg Foundation. I have to say, CSIS enjoyed a phenomenal partnership with the Colonial Williamsburg Foundation, probably one of the best programs I've put forward on the future of Europe, which brought together European and American leaders in the most gorgeous setting at Colonial Williamsburg. So thank you for being traveling from Williamsburg. Ambassador Reiss was formerly the president of Washington College, an incredibly distinguished diplomatic career, served from 2003 to 2005 as the director of the Office of Policy Planning at the U.S. State Department under Secretary Powell, was appointed in December of 2003 as the president's special envoy for the Northern Ireland peace process, a position he continued through 2007 when he wasn't thinking about Northern Ireland. Ambassador Reiss has spent an enormous time thinking about North Korea and how we can help that particular challenge, which again is growing into an incredible challenge. So we are indeed very grateful that you're here. And then we have Ambassador Paula Dobriansky, certainly a familiar face. We're delighted you could be with us, Paula. Paula serves as senior fellow at the Future of Diplomacy Project at Harvard Kennedy School, the Belford Center for Science and International Affairs. Prior to this position, she was Senior Vice President and Global Head of Government and Regulatory Affairs at Thomson Reuters. But so many of us know you from your distinguished service at the State Department from 2001 to 2009 as Undersecretary of State for Democracy and Global Affairs. She did have the world in her portfolio and did an enormous range of issues, energy, health, environment, development, humanitarian issues. And in her spare time, she was the President's Special Envoy to Northern Ireland. And when Senator Mitchell gets here, I will just keep moving down and I'll introduce Senator Mitchell here. But we're going to turn to Dan first, who will give us, again, sort of set the table, if you will, for where we are today, and then we will proceed. So welcome. A colleague from the embassy said, you've given us Irish weather today, so puts us in a frame of mind. So I'm going to say that's why we have our rainy weather this morning. But thank you and welcome, Dan, please.
Heather, thank you very much, and thank you to CSIS for the invitation to be here today. I'm really honored to be here with so many distinguished guests. Only a glance out to this audience knows how distinguished all of you really are, and so many colleagues as well. But also to be on the panel with such diplomatic giants. As Consul General in Belfast, I travel every day in the footsteps of the tremendous work that Senator Mitchell and his team did to forge the Good Friday Agreement 18 years ago. And I'm also frequently reminded of the outstanding work that Ambassadors Reiss and Dobriansky did to consolidate peace and to promote transatlantic prosperity. And it's also a privilege to work so closely with Secretary Kerry's personal representative, Senator Gary Hart, who wanted to be here, but because of a conflicting commitment, could not be here. My task this morning is to share some reflections on the new Northern Ireland. And I'll also highlight one particular challenge as well. Let's start with the Fresh Start Agreement reached last November. That was the third set of intensive cross-party negotiations in as many years. And last autumn, there was real concern that Northern Ireland's devolved institutions could collapse. However, patience, perseverance, and reason prevailed. Former First Minister Peter Robinson and current First Minister Arlene Foster and Deputy First Minister Martin McGuinness, they all deserve tremendous credit for the considerable work they did and the political courage they demonstrated. So do Secretary of State for Northern Ireland Teresa Villiers and Irish Foreign Minister Charlie Flanagan, and of course, Senator Hart. So what's new? Why is Northern Ireland in a much better place in 2016 than it was in 2015 or before? Well, the Fresh Start Agreement not only saved devolved government, it also made it stronger. New elements of power sharing include a reduction in the number of executive departments from 12 to 9. To forge a more cohesive executive. It includes a requirement that the parties that form the next regional government agree on a collective program of government first. It formalizes a role for an official opposition. And there's also a cross-party commitment to rid society of residual paramilitary organizations. On May 5th, the voters of Northern Ireland will elect 108 members of the region's Legislative Assembly. And we may be seeing a generational shift in Northern Ireland politics, one less marked or grounded in the deep sectarian divisions of the past. As President Obama noted at the White House St. Patrick's Day reception just a few weeks ago, 18 years of peace means that peace can vote now. Over 30 of the 108 members of the Legislative Assembly who were elected in 2011 are not standing for election in 2016. New people often bring fresh perspectives and ideas. Moreover, after the May 5 legislative elections, there are no scheduled polls for elected office in Northern Ireland for 3 years, and that gives potential political space for all parties to focus on effective governance. With respect to prosperity, the Fresh Start Agreement put the Northern Ireland government on a sustainable footing, resolving a protracted budget crisis. The parties have also set a date for a rate. That is to say, they have agreed to reduce the corporation tax to 12.5% by April 2018, the same rate that Ireland has. So if in 2015 political discussions stalled over welfare reform or the distribution of wealth, in 2016 there's renewed focus on the creation of wealth and jobs in Northern Ireland. The United States plays a significant role in Northern Ireland's economy. We are the biggest foreign direct investor in Northern Ireland, accounting for one-third for all foreign direct investment there. There are over 170 U.S. firms doing business in the region, generating an estimated 24,000 jobs. And I'm pleased to say there's a growing knowledge economy in Northern Ireland, with excellent prospects in many fields, such as information technology, biomedicine, legal and financial services, and the creative industries. Northern Ireland firms are exporting significantly more to the United States, and a number of innovative firms based in Northern Ireland have opened facilities and created jobs in the United States. The Secretary's Special Representative for Global Partnerships, Drew O'Brien, led a small U.S. trade and investment delegation to Northern Ireland in early March. And we hope that successful visit will lead to an even larger visit in the autumn. And I should mention, the First Minister, Arlene Foster, and Deputy First Minister, Martin McGuinness, visited New York City. They were here in Washington, D.C., and California, also in March, to promote trade and investment. Two-way trade and investment with Northern Ireland creates jobs on both sides of the Atlantic. Moreover, prosperity consolidates the peace. I also want to mention one particular remaining challenge. The Fresh Start Agreement did not establish government bodies to deal effectively with the legacy of the Troubles. The Stormont House Agreement names those bodies, and during the Fresh Start negotiations last year, considerable consensus was reached on how those entities would function. Nevertheless, those bodies have not yet been established, in large part due to an ongoing disagreement over how to handle the disclosure of national security information to the families of victims and survivors. But there seems to be consensus that setting up legacy bodies is a humanitarian imperative for grieving families. It's also vital for any post-conflict society trying to build a better future together. Leaders on all sides have all stated publicly that they want to get there. So in short, Heather, Northern Ireland has made enormous advances since the Good Friday Agreement was signed 18 years ago. Progress is not always linear, may not be as fast as many would like it to be either, but the positive trajectory is clear. Senator Mitchell, I know you famously said that you, in negotiations, had 700 days of failure followed by one day of success. I think what we can say since that historic moment 18 years ago is that the people of Northern Ireland are creating more successes every day. And I'm proud, as the Consul General in Belfast, to say that the American government and the American people continue to help in any way we can. Thank you.
Dan, thank you so much. And it's a perfect way to segue to Senator Mitchell. Thank you for braving Washington's traffic, which is always more challenging when the rain comes, to be with us. Senator Mitchell served as U.S. Special Envoy for the Middle East peace process from January 2009 to 2011, and certainly an incredibly distinguished career in the U.S. Senate for 15 years, six of those serving as Majority Leader. We're bringing you back to a time when, in 1995, you served as special advisor to President Clinton on Ireland and then served as 4 years as the independent chairman of the Northern Ireland peace talks. You have toggled back and forth between Northern Ireland and the Middle East peace challenge, 2000 to 2001. Senator Mitchell was asked to serve as the chairman of the International Fact-Finding Committee on Violence in the Middle East. You have an incredible, distinguished career. And Dan, you absolutely stole the quote that I thought is going to be a mandatory quote for every diplomat, particularly that are dealing with very difficult negotiations, to put on their wall. We had 700 days of failure and one day of success. And we're so grateful that you were successful in 1998. So, Senator Mitchell, we thought we'd just turn to you to offer some reflections on your own experience on the peace accords, reflecting or projecting forward in the challenges to come. And then we're just going to go down chronological order from your successors. We'll have Ambassador Reiss and then Ambassador Dobriansky offer their reflections, and then we'll have a few questions. So please, okay. Thank you for being with us today.
Well, thank you very much for having me, and thanks to CSIS for putting this event on. I do apologize for being late, to my fellow panelists and to the members of the audience. I just flew down from New York this morning, so getting here took a little longer than expected. I was heartened to hear the consul's comments, particularly about the economics of Northern Ireland and the importance of continued American support in that regard. The very first assignment I had in Northern Ireland was when President Clinton asked me to serve as his special representative, and it was a limited task in both time and subject matter. What he asked me to do was to organize a White House conference on trade and investment in Northern Ireland, which was held in May of 1995, for the purpose of trying to underpin the then nascent efforts at a renewed peace process. Ceasefires had been declared in the summer and fall of 1994. There was some feeling that it might be possible after previous several failed efforts earlier to get it going, and the conference was held. It was an absolute downpour, much worse than today.
So
everybody was late getting there. Even the president was late, and he had to just walk a few feet from the White House to the big tent where we held it on the South Lawn. But it proved to be quite successful. And since then, I think the United States has played and can play an important role in economic growth and development, because as I was in a very emotional way informed on my very first day in Northern Ireland, just a few weeks after I left the Senate, I went to Northern Ireland for the first time, and I was invited to meet with two groups from each of the two communities separately on their own sides of the peace line. It was a very well-attended and quite emotional day on both sides. To my surprise, it was the very first day I'd ever spent in Belfast. The messages were, although not in any way coordinated, were quite similar. And they were best summarized by a very powerful and emotional statement made by a Protestant minister from Northern Ireland, Jackie Redpath. There, many of you here will know him. He's still very active. I saw him just Sunday. I was in Dublin and had a meeting with him, and we reminisced about that first day when he brought with him two maps, one which showed the levels of unemployment in the urban areas of Northern Ireland, and the other which showed the levels of violence in the urban areas of Northern Ireland. And not surprisingly, they fit very closely. And Jackie made a very powerful statement about the importance of hope, opportunity, education, efforts to reduce and eliminate despair in the lives of the people. He's still working on it. We're both involved in an effort at economic development in the Shankill area. It ties right in with the comments that were made here earlier. And I tell all American audiences that everybody can be a peacemaker. And in fact, ordinary citizens can contribute as much or more as any public officials on this stage or anywhere else by investing in, going to, participating in the economic life of Northern Ireland. So I really do welcome those comments. I'll just add briefly that when I had the great privilege of announcing that the agreement had been reached, it's almost exactly now 18 years ago, I said in my statement and in the dozens of interviews I held that evening and the next day that the agreement did not in and of itself guarantee peace or political stability or reconciliation. it made them possible. It was a political agreement, imperfect, the best that could be done by determined and courageous political leaders at the time, but didn't solve every problem. We pushed down the road difficult issues, authorized the creation of commissions to deal with them. We recognized that it would be a very long time before it took hold. I told a story that evening of a visit I'd made to the Balkans. I was very much involved in that in the latter part of my years in the Senate. And I went to a town on the border of Bosnia and Croatia that had been about half Serb and half Croat before the war broke out. When the war started, the Serb forces were in the ascendancy, and they came to the town. The Serbs in the town joined with the paramilitaries. They took control of the town, and they burned down every building that was owned by a Croat. About 18 months later, the tide of war turned, and the Croatian forces gained the ascendancy. They came to the town, they allied with the local residents, and they burned down every building in the town earned by a Serb. So by the time we got there, I and a group of other senators, there was hardly a building left standing intact. And I asked the mayor how long it would be, in his estimation, before Serbs and Croats could again live together in peace in this town. And he said, he was a thoughtful young man, he said after a long pause, he said, "We will repair our buildings and our bridges long before we repair our souls." Meaning, of course, that the physical structures, political structures can be built or created, but changing what's in people's hearts and minds, which is the most important task of all, takes a very long time and a tremendous degree of persistence and perseverance. I've said often that the real heroes of the process in Northern Ireland were the political leaders of Northern Ireland, men and women who had spent their entire lives in conflict, but who at a moment of crisis and opportunity in their society came together with a great deal of courage. But that would be necessary for a long period of time, and still is necessary, because the society remains segregated in education and social life and in many other areas of activity. No one, I think, could fairly describe it as total and genuine reconciliation. So it's going to take effort, and thank goodness Northern Ireland has been blessed with a succession of courageous political leaders. In every democracy, including our own, it's fashionable, of course, to denigrate, to ridicule, to demean political leaders, and heaven knows many of them earn it by their statements and actions all around the globe. But it is also true that we have to recognize that in some places, political leaders have risen to the occasion. Ordinary men and women, with all the weaknesses and faults of humans and politicians everywhere, but who found a way to make it work and to expand it, and I'm very, very much heartened by what I see. When I was in Dublin on Sunday, I did a series of interviews, and one reporter asked what they always ask, well, isn't it terrible what's going on in Northern Ireland, all the fussing and the feuding going on? I said, well, look, I just came from the United States, and if you want to hear a political fussing and feuding, you come over and turn on the television for 10 minutes in America. So there is a tendency of all of us to be self-critical. I think that's particularly true in Northern Ireland, and many people establish a standard that is higher than that applies in any other society on earth. So of course they have problems, they have difficulties, they have disagreements. That's human life. That's the development of human society. So I'm an American, I'm very proud of it, but a very large heart of my heart and my emotions will always be in Northern Ireland, so I'm no longer truly objective, but I think they're terrific, they're energetic, they're very productive. The 170 American businesses are getting their money's worth in Northern Ireland. that I can assure you, because they're hardworking. They are quarrelsome. They are often quick to take offense, real or imagined. But it's to me, it's a source of great satisfaction that I had the chance to participate.
Thank you so much, Senator Mitchell. I love that idea that everyone can be a peacemaker and everyone can play a role. It's a wonderful image. Ambassador Reiss, let me turn to you for reflections from your time as Special Envoy and the particular challenges that you dealt with.
Thank you, Heather. I want to thank my fellow panelists, especially Senator Mitchell. We all worked in your shadow, but for your heroic efforts, I don't think any of us would be sitting here today. So. Thank you for that. I also want to give a shout out to Ambassador Barbara Stevenson, who was the Consulate General in Belfast during two of the 4 years I was the President's Special Envoy. It was great fun, great pleasure, and we did great work together. So thank you, Barbara. I actually want to pick up on something that Daniel said earlier, which is that late last year there was a growing concern that the process of reconciliation, the political process in Northern Ireland was coming undone. There was an uptick in paramilitary violence. There were threats to leave the government. People in London that I spoke with were actually more worried in private than they were letting on in public. They were extremely concerned that things were not going to end well in 2015. But as Daniel said, the ship was righted. And so I always wonder why things don't happen. You know, it's none of this is inevitable, of course. And why is the process continuing? Why have we been able to continue with the success that Daniel mentioned, to build on the legacy that Senator Mitchell gave to all of us? And I think the reason for that is that, by and large, the political process has worked. Despite all the flaws, the very human flaws that the Senator mentioned with the political leadership there, it has more or less worked. Economics, again, subsidies from London, which we don't talk about very often, but those are important, to give time for the foreign direct investment to come in. That bridge was very important. Hopefully over time, Northern Ireland can be a flourishing economy where there are many, many jobs created for the young people in particular. I understand that there is an equal percentage now of both Catholics and Protestants employed in Northern Ireland. Again, one of those interesting data points that I think is another sign that the peace process is more resilient than perhaps we often give it credit for. And despite the fact that very little of this could be done without political leadership, I really think that the true heroes in Northern Ireland are the people themselves. I think Barbara and I talked often about how far ahead of the leadership the average man or woman on the street was. They wanted the violence to end. They wanted a normal life for themselves and for their children. They wanted a better future. And I think they were the ones who continue to push for a normal society where every child can reach their potential and they can live in peace. It's what we all want for our folks here. So I don't think there's much difference there. And again, I just think that sometimes we get caught up in the day-to-day drama, which is understandable, but there is a very solid foundation for this to continue in Northern Ireland. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Paula, please.
Thank you. First, let me say thank you, Heather, to CSIS and also the State Department. Katie's here. Thank you for bringing us all together. I, too, want to pay my respect to Senator Mitchell. I had the great privilege of, when I took the mantle of the Special Envoyship, of talking with all of my predecessors, and I certainly benefited greatly during my tenure from that. I also, with Mitchell, Ambassador Mitchell Reiss, interestingly enough, when the baton was passed from him to me, we took a trip together to Belfast, We were in Dundalk and also in Dublin and London. And I think that that also really was an important aspect of a transition governmentally, that we were on the same page and also during a very crucial time. And Barbara, welcome. It's very good to see you. I wanted to recognize, because we do have a number of people here, Congressman Jim Walsh at the back there, who has been very committed, former head of the Irish Caucus in Congress and very involved in Cooperation Ireland, which seeks to promote integrated education in Northern Ireland. And I'm also going to let someone who most of you wouldn't necessarily know in this community, but the former Spanish ambassador, Jaime Ruperez, is here, and was a former hostage, by the way, of the Basque separatists in Spain, and terrorists in Spain. So I did want to recognize him and that he's here. Let me say a few words. I'm going to speak a little bit longer than Mitchell, but not as long, if I may say, as the senator, because you get the most amount of time. But I do want to say this. When I took the on the position, it was actually a very interesting time, and a time of great expectation, also hope, and also skepticism. And I remember it so well, because January of 2007, there was the Ardesh in which Gerry Adams renounced violence, and there was an attempt to embrace certainly policing reforms. Then also later, there was the embracement that spring by Reverend Paisley of also of policing reforms. There were the elections in May of 2007, and all have spoken up here about the impact of the people of Northern Ireland. I have to underscore that tenfold, because to me it was very graphic in that election that they basically indicated to all the political parties, if you're going to represent us, we want you to be focused on bread and butter issues, about issues that are going to affect our community, where we're going. We want a renunciation of violence. And, you know, the elections took place, and then the next thing that I remember was economy, of course, was front and center, and there was the diplomatic factor that was kicking in here on discussions of how one goes forward and how one tries to really get the devolution of power in the institutions. And what was very striking was the fact, and I remember this, when Reverend Paisley and Martin McGuinness both went to London, and they had a discussion in London with Prime Minister Blair about the future economy. And I think, by the way, there was a united front coming from Belfast on that issue. And interestingly enough, you know, there was some real hard discussions that took place. And, you know, the next thing you know, there was, in fact, the devolution of power. It was truly historic. I remember it so well. I had the privilege of going with Senator Kennedy. I was the head of delegation. But quite candidly, everyone there wanted to get Senator Kennedy's perspective on what happened in Belfast and what not only a gentleman, but what a really just a incredible and extraordinary human being he was. When we were there, why I reference this, there was, as I said, this hope, this expectation, this feeling of going forward, and that there was really an opportunity here. You know, the next piece in that puzzle was that First Minister Paisley and Deputy First Minister McGuinness came to the United States on my watch, and they met with President Bush. And why I share this with you, because just that visit in of itself was a focus on what did they want to represent? What was the constructive agenda that they were putting forward? Again, in terms of the chronology, I saw an upward and literally a positive, forward-looking. I'm not suggesting that there weren't differences and there weren't tensions. Believe me, there were. But at the same time, that was also being framed and in a way that they had to look forward. We also, during my tenure, we also looked at the issue of business. And all here have mentioned the importance of the economy, the people, and the attraction of investment. We had, a year later, a business investment conference in May of 2008, and it was phenomenal. There were 90 companies that came, great representation. There were a lot of deals that just in that time had been cut. And you also had a change of leadership. Then the Taoiseach was Brian Cowan. You had Gordon Brown as the Prime Minister in London, and then President Bush. All three came together in support of that business investment conference. So did all the political parties of Northern Ireland, because they knew that this was very much in their interest, in the interest in the future of Northern Ireland itself. It was a real success. I had to say that because thinking of where we are now, and that was the first foundation that galvanized these parties and did provide a specific agenda which they all came together on. I'll mention one last in terms of events that sticks out in my mind. Before the end of the Bush administration, I went with President Bush, in fact, to Belfast, and the topic at hand was the devolution of policing, and literally to have that agenda pushed and concluded. And I remember when he sat down with then Peter Robinson in the position and Martin McGuinness, and really he turned his chair around, you know, taking it so the back is facing him, and he's looking at the two of them, and just literally, you know, they're almost just alone together. All of us are sort of over on the side. And he really said, you know, this is your opportunity as leaders to make a difference, to really take this and put this in your hands. And you know the rest that happened thereafter. It took a little bit, but it happened. And when I think about these pieces, I would say that in looking back in hindsight, two things. First, that in terms of what has really impacted Northern Ireland's course, the people have made a difference. I think they've always spoken. They will continue to speak. They have an investment in their own future and want to see it right. And then secondly, I would say that the diplomatic elements, I think, came together. I think were useful in being supportive, in pushing that process forward. But I also think there was the courage of the leaders themselves. And that's what I see in terms of this next chapter. And that is the political courage of the leaders themselves to take it to the next stage in bringing about the changes that are definitely desired and definitely wanted. So I will end there, but I think it is an important story, and not only story, but it hasn't ended, but it's on a very good path.
Paula, thank you so much. What a wonderful, rich discussion. What I thought we'd do now is I'll ask our panelists a few questions and then open the floor to, in some ways, I wish we could invite the audience to, some of them could be the panelists up here as well. So please, we welcome your questions. I thought I'd start to begin outward a little bit, sort of at the macro level. Each one of you talked about economics, and one question that is looming quite large is the upcoming June 23rd referendum, UK referendum on the EU, and the economic impact of that decision. It also is an issue of potential border restitution, which may cause some new political challenges. We have, I believe it was Martin McGuinness who's calling for a border poll, should in fact a decision be made to leave the European Union. So I would welcome all four of our panelists' reflections on this upcoming referendum and its impact on this peace process. I think sometimes we underestimate the larger ramifications of this, and obviously President Obama is going to be traveling to London at the end of the month and speaking about the impact the U.S. and our view. We just heard the IMF this morning come out with some very strong words, the belief that a decision to leave could have significant regional and global economic implications. So I thought maybe, Dan, we'll just sort of walk down the panel. If you could offer some reflections as you're looking from your position in Belfast at this upcoming June 23rd referendum.
Well, Heather, thank you. Thank you for that. And again, it's such a great audience here, and I just also want to give a shout out to our Deputy Assistant Secretary Conrad Tribble, our Office Director for Western European Affairs, who are over here from the State Department and their teams. which is all the more reason that he should be careful in how I answer this. So, no, I think you've brought up a very valid point. This is a decision that many economists say would have a profound impact on a regional economy of 1.8 million people. It is the only part of the UK that does share a land border with an EU member state. So it is an important decision. There's no question about that. I'll just share a fact. 4 out of the 5 leading parties in Northern Ireland do support remaining in the European Union. But also another fact is that the preponderance of votes are not in Northern Ireland when you look at the United Kingdom as a whole. I should, and I'm always on safe ground quoting the President of the United States, so I will say here that President Obama has noted that this is a decision for UK voters to decide, while at the same time reaffirming continued U.S. support for a strong United Kingdom in a strong European Union. So I think being in government, I'll leave it at that and let others who are out of government at this time say a few more.
Well, I actually think that it would be very bad for the United States if the UK decided on June 23rd to leave the EU. The topic today is Northern Ireland. So two consequences, I think, that we could probably agree upon. All the economic analyses that I've looked at suggest that it would be damaging, at least in the near term, next 5 to 10 years, to the British economy if they left the Union. A lot of it would depend on the terms they negotiated, but let's just assume that that's correct. Then it's likely that that economic distress is going to find its way to Northern Ireland in some shape or form. So that's one, probably not the best thing for the Northern Ireland economy. The second is, I think a lot of the young people are really proud of the fact, in Northern Ireland, they're proud of the fact that they're European. And I think younger people, I think generally, tend to see their identity that way, at least the ones that I've met in Ireland. So I can anticipate that there would be a brain drain, where the most talented people who have the most options in Northern Ireland might want to opt out. And they could go either south or they could go to other places because they'd have choices. And so again, I think the combination of perhaps an economic downturn with a bit of a brain drain of the most talented folks that you have there, and less attractiveness, getting back to the foreign direct investment point, less attractiveness for American companies to invest in Northern Ireland, sort of a triple whammy. So I don't think this would be a terribly good development from the perspective of the peace process.
Now, I share the sentiments expressed by the two previous speakers. First, of course, it is a decision for the voters of the United Kingdom to make, but you asked, and we're entitled to express our views. I think it would be bad for the people of the UK, first and foremost. I think very bad for Northern Ireland for some of the reasons that Mitchell has already described. In Dublin on Sunday, I met with many of the leaders of the Government of Ireland. They are very, very much opposed to the UK leaving, thinking it will have a very negative effect on them as well. I think the larger issue is much more than the political interests of just the United States or the UK or Ireland. I spoke in Brussels a few months ago, and on the program with me was Herman Rompuy, the former head of the EU. And when I expressed the views I've just expressed, he called it, he said, the European Union is a peace project. It like many of the other international institutions, NATO, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, they were all created in the aftermath of the Second World War, which was the third time in 75 years that the continent and the people of Europe had been devastated by major land wars. And the objective, while they are political, military, they are ultimately intended to entangle all of the nations of Europe into a web of relationships in all of these dimensions, political, military, economic, and other, that would make less likely a recurrence of what happened in 1870, 1930, 1914, and 1939. And we're all, it's a healthy thing that democracies are self-critical. It's a, in fact, indeed, it's an essential element of the success of democracies. But we also have to recognize when we have been successful. And I don't think there is a better example of far-sighted and successful American diplomacy than the role the United States played, given its dominant economic and military strength at the conclusion of the Second World War, in leading the way toward establishing these institutions. And the one thing we can say about human beings is that we all have short memories. And it may seem to us in 2016 unthinkable that what happened three times in 75 years prior to 1945 could occur again, but history tells us that it is very thinkable. And so I think that, I hope the debate elevates. Unfortunately, it appears to be going in the opposite direction. One of the reasons, I believe, that those who favor exiting are doing better is that the debate over Britain leaving the European Union has become entangled in the competition for succession within the Conservative Party in the UK. And internal and domestic political considerations are driving people in directions that I think are short-sighted and not taking into account the long-range interests of the people, not just of Europe, not specifically of Northern Ireland or of Ireland or the United States, but all of Europe, and given Europe's central role in the world, economically, politically, morally, in so many ways. I mean, the after Athens, the formative place of democracy as we know it, and a way of living that we all take for granted. I think it's a critical decision, and I hope very much that there will be a decision not to leave.
I have to say, Senator Mitchell, from everyone who's a devoted transatlanticist, amen. Thank you, Paula.
That should probably be my statement here. Just two things, because it really has been extremely well said down the line here. Certainly, we have to respect whatever the outcome is, but I'm in this lineup. I come down on the same exact position that I hope that it will stay, Britain will stay in the European Union. And to me, the greatest consequence for Northern Ireland, here I shared with you my involvement with the Business Investment Conference and all the type of foreign direct investment there, this will have definitively, if Britain decides to jump out, it will have direct consequences, as has been very well stated. One footnote to what Senator Mitchell said, which was a broader point. I'm very concerned about just the broader issue of European institutions and their being challenged at this time from different directions. And the whole question of the liberal international order, which has preserved peace, stability, and security since World War II, since the Cold War, and what direction is this going to take? This is a crucial piece of that direction.
Could I have one comment about Northern Ireland's self-interest? Everybody here knows, particularly people from Northern Ireland who are here, that there are very deep historical, ethnic, and other ties between Northern Ireland and Scotland. And I think a decision by the United Kingdom to depart the European Union, given the very strong support for the European Union that exists in Scotland, and given the relationship, given what's developed, would, in my judgment, significantly increase the likelihood of another vote in Scotland, and one that might go the other way if the EU left. And to me, I'm not from Northern Ireland, but I think that knowing the people there well and knowing many people in Scotland, to think that Northern Ireland and Scotland would be in different countries is simply so inconsistent with their whole history, which continues to this day. There, I've spoken at several universities in Scotland. They always have a receiving line, and it's still unbelievable to me how many youngsters come up and say, "I'm from Belfast. I'm from Coleraine. I'm from every place in Northern Ireland." It seems like half the universities in Scotland are filled with youngsters from Northern Ireland. And the exchanges back and forth are so deep and meaningful. I just think it would be harmful to Northern Ireland, even eliminating the direct financial or economic impact, but just in terms of their history and their relationship with Scotland.
You know, we were recognizing people, and I wanted to mention, because we mentioned Northern Ireland, we have, of course, our colleague here from the Irish Embassy. I'm going to feature, if I may, we have Norman Houston here, who is the head of the Northern right. Ireland Bureau here, and I think you're very focused on these issues these days.
Thank you so much. I'd like to turn to a question actually that I received this morning by email, and I was so delighted as we are live streaming this so many others can watch it, not just here in Washington. And I want to, maybe this is a little more concentrated for you, Senator Mitchell. I want to bring you back to the few months following signing of the Good Friday Peace Accords, and we had the Omagh bombing, which was the greatest loss of life, single loss of life in the, during yes. the Troubles, 29 lives lost, well over 200 injured. And so I want to provide the question that was provided to me by the survivors group here. The question is, Section 6 of the Good Friday Agreement emphasizes the achievement of a peaceful and just society would be the true memorial to the victims of violence, and the victims have a right to remember as well as to contribute to a changed society. The victims are still very much waiting for justice from that bombing. We saw last month Seamus Daly, the only one that was charged, is those proceedings are no longer going to continue. So, Senator Mitchell, I ask you sort of for your reflections of what that meant, but really this goes to Dan's point about the legacy of the historical reconciliation. There is a role for civil society here. This is part of the healing process. But if you could speak specifically to that event and perhaps to the victims' families, where your thoughts are today.
I recently published a book in which I wrote about my experience in Omagh. And it's very emotional and very meaningful to me. And I think it is an enormous tragedy and a failure of the justice system that no one has ever spent a day in prison for a terrible atrocity in which 29 people were killed, and I believe the number is over 330 grievously injured. Shortly after the bombing, I received a call from the White House, asked if I would travel to Omagh with President Clinton. And we went just a few days later. I participated in a large public event in a recreational center in Omagh. It was a very warm and humid night. A huge crowd had gathered. The president spoke, and the prime minister of the UK spoke. And then they asked each of us to go to separate parts of the room and meet individually with families of survivors. And I met with many of them, spent several hours there. It was truly an emotional event, one of the most emotional grieving events I've ever been involved in. And I recall two of the people with whom I met. One of them was a young woman, then 15. Her name is Claire Gallagher. She was an aspiring pianist, and in the terrible blast, she was seriously injured and lost both eyes. It's a little more detail than you need, but I think it's important to say that Omagh is a market town where on the weekends, particularly the Saturdays, people from the surrounding areas come into the town to shop and to socialize. And as often happened, those who planted the bomb telephoned in warnings. In fact, there were two of them. But no one has been able to establish precisely what happened, but there was a misunderstanding by the police who thought that the bomb was placed in the town square, the municipal building, and began urging people to leave that. And so people started walking and then walking faster and then running out of the town square. And one of the outlet streets, Market Street, is quite narrow with buildings on both sides. And people raced down that street to get away from the town square, not knowing that they were racing toward the bomb. The bomb, a 500-pound bomb, had been placed in a car of Vauxhall and parked on the street. And so you had this crowd of people rushing down this crowded street. And when the bomb went off, they literally had the car surrounded. And of course, it was filled with shrapnel, and people were cut down just like a huge scythe through a stand of grain. And Claire Gallagher was close to the point of impact and was struck in the face and shoulders by huge pieces of hot metal. And the injuries were just horrific. Then I met a young man, Michael Monahan, who was 33. He was in Omaha that morning with his wife, who was pregnant. Their 18-month-old daughter, and his wife's mother. And all of the women were killed. You can imagine three generations and a fourth one on the way, all killed instantly. And he described in a very emotional way how his two-year-old son asked him every day, when's mommy coming home? So it was just an awful, awful incident. And it is, I feel it personally because I've been back to Omaha several times, that it is just a terrible failure of the system, that there was one conviction which was overturned on appeal, and there was a civil suit, but to think that some murderer who, I can't even begin to think what anyone could be in anyone's mind doing something like this, would cause so much devastation and damage, and no one face a day in prison. And I'm completely sympathetic with the victims, their anger, their outrage at that, and it just reminds us of we in the English-speaking democracies have devised systems of justice that we believe are the most fair in the world. But they're human institutions run by humans, and they often fail. And there was and remains an enormous failure in this respect.
No, it is an extraordinary story. Thank you for those comments. Dan, I wanted to turn to you, and it sort of segues into we still have paramilitary groups that are working. The new IRA has certainly stated that violence will continue. I'm wondering if you could give us some thoughts as you see this challenge. How can these groups be, decommission the violence end?
Well, sure, Heather. I think you're absolutely right. The new Northern Ireland that I described, a much more of a prosperous, much more forward-looking society that's emerging. It's really the result of the heroic actions of everyday people creating this virtuous circle. And it's unfortunate in any peace process that virtuous circle can at times be broken by just a few people who try to put society back into a vicious cycle of violence. But I think it's clear to me that Northern Ireland rejects violence. That the persons who are trying to subvert the peace are small groups. But the reality is that armed gangs do remain in certain neighborhoods, and the rule of law on both sides of the community is not applied there because of these armed gangs. And I should mention in particular dissident Republicans' despicable March 4th car bomb attack on a prison officer in Belfast, Adrian Ismay, who died just 11 days later. It reminds us all that there's critical work that still needs to be done. The Fresh Start Agreement did establish a three-person commission, and they're developing a comprehensive strategy to phase out residual paramilitary organizations, and their recommendations are due in the coming months. Northern Ireland and Ireland, as a result of the Fresh Start Agreement, also formed a joint task force to tackle cross-border organized crime. And I should also mention that the International Fund for Ireland, it sponsors peace impact programs in communities for positive community transformation so that young people, this generation that can vote for peace, doesn't vote for violence. There's quite a bit of tremendous work being done. It's difficult work, but it's important work, and of course it has to succeed.
Let me turn to the panelists. Have any reflections on the paramilitary organizations during your times as special envoys? Any particular reflections? It's a difficult issue, but it's what maintains this pressure, if you will, that allows the violence to continue.
Sure. You know, maybe I'm just a little bit of a contrarian. So one of the things that I actually took a little bit of solace from was when the paramilitary gangs were robbing banks and holding up liquor stores and doing a variety of things that common criminals and thugs do. There was no romance to this. These were not actions in service to a larger political ideal. It was craven. It was base. And that's, in fact, what much of the violence has become. It's not idealistic. It's not romantic. I think Irish America woke up to that early on and figured this out. That was an important aspect when I was the special envoy. They spoke with a loud voice that this type of behavior was simply unacceptable. And so the fact that there's still criminal behavior going on, it has nothing to do with the peace process. Let's be very honest about it. It's criminal behavior. And people need to call it out for what it is, not try to glorify it or excuse it in any way. And I think that that's a first step to actually addressing it properly.
My last question before I turn the questions over to our audience is, looking at May 5th, Dan, you mentioned, you know, the polls suggest we may not see much changing, but as you reflected, it's a new generation in some ways that is voting. Are there any, and I'll open this to the panel, are there any issues that we should be looking for in the May 5th election? We have the challenge, we don't have a government in Dublin yet. It's still in process of formation, we hope. So just wondering the politics of this, any concerns that we may not be completely recognizing at this moment?
Well, I think, just reflecting personally, Heather, I think the May 5th election process is a reflection of the political maturation in Northern Ireland. The issues being discussed are, I think, as Ambassador Dobriansky said, bread and butter issues which any Western democracy has to deal with. And, you know, I think there also is a, and I'll just, again, reflecting personally, what you often hear in the most scientific of polls, which I always say are taxi drivers and shop assistants in every neighborhood, what you often hear is that you know, people want devolved government to work and to work effectively. And I think what you're hearing from all the major parties is they want to make it work. And again, I think the more that the political leadership of Northern Ireland pulls together, the more, the better chance they have of changing Northern Ireland's brand, of creating the economy that that positions themselves and their children and grandchildren in much better circumstances.
Yeah. I think it's something we're going to watch, but obviously very closely, and then in some ways in the lead up to the June 23rd referendum. All right, I'm sorry I've dominated the conversation too much. It's been such a privilege. Let me turn this over to our audience. We have microphones available. If you could raise your hand and introduce yourself. And if you have a question that's directed to any of the panelists, please do. If not, we can take a few and the panelists can respond to them. Do we have any questions? We have so many good minds in this room. I know there are questions. Sophie's one right in the front. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Sharon Kotak, and I think this question is probably more for Senator Mitchell. Could you speak a little bit about the contribution of women's peace organizations to the Good Friday Peace Accords? And also, are women continually, do they continue to remain involved in pushing for peace in Northern Ireland? Thank you.
Please.
Women played a critical role in the process while I was there and engaged. I think it was not purely in the form of direct entry into politics, but in the development of a mood throughout the whole society that the fear and anxiety that had become so widespread made ordinary life impossible. And women were in the leadership for a long time in encouraging efforts to bring about peace. They then were able to organize the Northern Ireland Women's Party was organized as a consequence of the mechanism by which the process advanced. It was complicated, but testament to the genius of the career civil servants, both of the UK and Irish governments, who I have to say are among the finest and most able public officials or people I've ever met. The problem was that, I have to oversimplify this so I don't give too long, I've already given too many long answers, but there was a strong desire for an election, but a feeling that while Sinn Féin, which was allied with the IRA, was strong enough politically to win an election, the loyalist paramilitaries, through their political wings, were not. And so we struggled with trying to figure out how to do it so that the loyalists could win in an election and gain entry first to the forum and through the forum to the political negotiations. And an ingenious group of civil servants really came up with the idea that since there were five significant political parties in Northern Ireland, two unionists, two nationalists, and the Alliance Party, which crossed both, they would run the election and seats at the negotiating table would be reserved for the 10 political parties that scored in the ballot. Well, there were only five parties, so that created literally an opening for the loyalist parties to come in, and they did with very small numbers in the voting. And the women, the leaders of the Northern Ireland Women's Party were first, two great women, Monica McWilliams, a nationalist, and Pearl Seeger, a unionist, and they got elected. I think they only got about 1% of the vote, but they were in the top 10. So they made it in, and after a little rough start, they were the object of a lot of rude behavior by some of the other participants early. They established themselves in a very strong and effective way, and they played a hugely disproportionate role, disproportionate to their vote and to their numbers at the table in the outcome. And so they... it's one of these circumstances in which you could point to 100 different factors and say, but for that factor, this wouldn't have occurred. And they certainly were one of a relatively few, the women of Northern Ireland generally and the women political leaders. And it's now, of course, I think a tremendous, both substantive and symbolic event that the First Minister of Northern Ireland is a woman.
Yeah, Paul, I know you want to have a comment.
I just wanted to add briefly, Sharon, your question, I think, is an excellent one because it's one in which there is, I think, often an untold story. On my watch, I had the benefit of meeting with a number of women, including Monica, and they were telling their role, their impact, and what had taken place during your time and their involvement. But I will also expand and just say it's striking to me that you have women who are involved in not only the political realm now, And of course, the selection of the First Minister being a woman. But also women have become very involved in NGOs and leading NGOs and are critical contributors to the reconciliation process, and also in business. And I think that's all for the good.
Great, we'll take another question we have there. Yes, sir, right in the center.
Jack Curley, I teach occasionally a course on Europe and used to be in the State Department. And I've always had a special interest in the European Union. Senator, I wonder, did 18 years ago, and in your sense of the negotiations, the shared membership in the European Union at that time play any sort of background role in the, you know, acceptability of coming together more, do you think?
It was a very significant factor in the mellowing of relations between the governments of the United Kingdom and Ireland. I don't think that, and this is obviously speculation, but my personal belief is that there would not have been this peace process but for the improvement of relations between the governments of the UK and Ireland, and I believe that improvement would not have occurred had the European Union not existed. Everybody here, obviously, and some will know much more about the history of relations between the two countries, but quite clearly, relations were strained. They were deeply strained during the Second World War. A lot of very hard feelings on both sides, and in the aftermath of that. But it took some time over the tenures of several prime ministers on both sides, but they developed a recognition that the conflict in the North would never be resolved unless the two governments cooperated in helping to resolve it, and that their continued hostile relationship, if it didn't contribute to the actual conflict, created a circumstance in which resolution of the conflict was not possible. And so I think, in a real sense, the existence of the European Union had a great deal to do with helping the governments come together. And I find it really amazing and heartwarming to see the relationship now. When I was in Dublin Sunday, I spoke at an event entitled Rising to Reconciliation, which marked the 100th anniversary of the Easter Rising, and the British ambassador was there. That would have been unthinkable a few years ago, and the comments made were not so offensive as to cause him to have to leave.
And
the government, President Higgins, the now acting Prime Minister, and the political leaders in Ireland all made a conscious effort to make sure that this was positive, forward-looking, recognized the past, acknowledged the past, not tried to whitewash it away. History is there, but the importance was placed on the present, the future, and the importance of peace and peaceful relations.
Yes, sir, right here.
Good morning. I'm Peter Rogers, a private citizen. To Senator Mitchell, historical question. Looking back, do you see a point in time in the 80s when conditions started to change? Do you look at what happened in the point in time in the 80s or early 90s, the conditions changed in Northern Ireland where the peace was possible? Because an observer from midnight up to the 1980s, it just seemed dismal, coming from the trouble starting in 1969. Can you identify a particular event or just sort of a change in attitudes of the people that peace was a possibility? Because in 1985-88, the 1998 peace accord would just be impossible to conceive of.
First, of course, was the improving relations between the two governments. That led them to conduct a postmortem on the failed talks that occurred in 1991. And what had happened in 1991 was they had the talks, but only what they termed the constitutional parties were permitted to participate. They were the parties that did not have paramilitary affiliations. And what the governments concluded was that, difficult as it is to accept, if you want to end a war, you can't exclude those who are fighting the war. It seems so obvious now in retrospect, one of many things in life that you look back and say, well, did it take a commission to figure that out? But then that created a new problem. Well, if they are going to participate, on what terms and conditions and circumstances can they participate? Particularly, can they come in a way that will not cause the constitutional parties to leave? Because just as conference involving just the constitutional parties could succeed, a conference involving just those who had paramilitaries could not succeed, because the constitutional parties, of course, represented the vast majority of the people of Northern Ireland. So that's when I first became involved, and and Prime Minister Major asked me to chair a group to look into there. The specific subject was prior decommissioning of weapons. And my colleagues and I, the former Prime Minister of Finland, Harry Hokeri, and Canadian Chief of General Staff, John de Chastelaine, held a series of public meetings and hearings, and we put together an effort that enabled them to go forward to have an election and then to proceed somewhat in the manner I described earlier. If you ask me what the single most important factor was, I think it was a collective, at first inchoate, but then developed attitude among the people of Northern Ireland that they couldn't go on living with the kind of fear and anxiety. When the conflict started, the principal military activity was the IRA, and they had a policy, a public policy, of limiting themselves to only military targets. Now, what is or is not a military target is a highly subjective judgment, but at first it was mostly soldiers and police. But gradually, it expanded, and when the loyalist paramilitaries entered the conflict in reaction to what they perceived was the lack of a sufficiently forceful military response by the British government, they didn't have any limitation, and pretty soon, on both sides, the killing was completely random, based solely on where you happened to live or what your religion was. And you had these horrific incidents that occurred in public places, restaurants, and buildings were bombed at random. And so I think it was a shock to people, even people who had grown up and been inured to long years of conflict. It was expanding steadily and spreading fear and anxiety. And to fast forward, we celebrate the Good Friday Agreement. It was this close to not coming into being. And it took a tremendous degree of courage by the then political leaders to take that step. And one of the motivating factors was the fear that if this process failed, the conflict would renew, and as been true throughout human history with the developments in weaponry and materials of destruction, the level of violence, the degree of destruction, the number of deaths would be exponentially larger than it had been the last round, just as the last round was over the round before. So I think all of those factors contributed to it in a meaningful way.
Senator, I agree completely. But may I respectfully suggest a couple of additional factors to consider. One is that during the 1980s, we saw Sinn Féin become successful in the political process. And what that did, I believe, is that it showed the leadership that there was another way forward for them. There was a pathway where they could go hand in hand with violence for a time, but at least it did promise that they could have some say in shaping the political future of Northern Ireland. I think that was significant. The other is a man whose name we haven't mentioned yet today, and that's John Hume. And I think John Hume's moral example and the philosophy that he was preaching was very important. I think it did contribute to the sense that the senator mentioned in society, that a fear that it was going to become worse, but also of exhaustion and a lack of morality that I think frightened people. So I think that all of these combined, as the senator said, there's 1,000 factors, but I think those two trends, in addition to the two that the senator mentioned, I thought were instrumental.
I completely agree, Mitchell. John Hume is and will be a monumental figure in Irish history, and he was the architect of the concepts that became the process. He wasn't the only guy sitting at the table, and he had very able help from Seamus Mallon and Mark Durkin and others, but John thought of it, and he had the moral authority, given the position he had taken, the risks he had taken, to have gained respect on all sides. And then the courage displayed by David Trimble and taking steps. And one of the great ironies of history is that they, having endured the most in the negotiating process, were immediately displaced by other parties in the subsequent governing process. And that's the way of human life and history. But I saw John on Sunday. He's physically actually looks very well, but he's still a figure that everyone admires. And I think history will judge very, very favorably.
This has been such a privilege and such a rich discussion, and I love the history, which we don't focus on enough, your positive vision, Senator Mitchell, and then the hard work and the passing of the baton to each successive special envoy. We know the work continues, and a point I want to make, Senator Mitchell, the continued need for societal integration. There is still too much separation. This is where I think women play an NGO's a historic role. The work continues. We know violence will continue, but I'm looking out in the window. When we started this conversation, it was raining. The sun has broken out. And I have to tell you, this has been one of the most rewarding and positive conversations. Please join me in thanking our extraordinary panel for a wonderful discussion. Have a wonderful day. Thank you.